The Apostle Paul writes to the church at Philippi, and it's recorded in the third chapter of Philippians, the 13th and 14th verse, where he says, "One thing I do is forgetting those things that are behind, I press on." This is most certainly an encouragement to Paul himself, but I believe an encouragement to the church at Philippi as well, because often this is what is needed. You know, in our journey, sometimes we grow stagnant. Sometimes we don't seem to move in God as we once did. Well, Moments of Life is an instrument in the hands of God to edify you and strengthen you and encourage you. I look forward to sharing with you every single week as we dive into the Word of God together and move into new revelation, new understanding, new knowledge that's going to increase your application of the Word of God and bring greater fruitfulness into your journey. We're going to go together as we dive into the Word moment by moment, for these moments of life are just for you. Great day. Such a joy to be able to rejoice in the Lord together. And I pray that the hand of God is moving so mightily on your life and in your life. I believe that delays are over. I believe that the supernatural of God is beginning to make its way into your life. I believe that the transformative power of God is enlarging you and enriching you. But more than anything, I believe the hunger for God is rising up inside of you. And that's one reason why you're tuned in to Moments of Life, is that you want more of God. You want more of the understanding of what it is to walk with God and to demonstrate a walk with God that actually has fruit, and not just fruit, but fruit that remains. And so I'm just humbled that the Lord would allow me to impart into your life. And I'm trusting that you're sharing this opportunity with so many other people. Don't just keep it to yourself. One thing about the kingdom of God is that the men and women in it must be distributors of its truth, distributors of what it stands for and what it means. And there are many people that I believe can benefit greatly, but they need to hear from you. You're the influence in their lives. And be told to come into this setting to be able to fellowship with us. You can do it in groups. You can pull people together to do it. Some people are telling me that they're creating small groups from these times together. And I'm just saying to you, however you can maximize the truth of the Lord, then let it be done. Let me pray for you, and we're going to get started today. Father, this is the day you've made. I prophesy that we will rejoice and be made glad in it. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. I declare that as we walk as the head and not the tail, we shall see the salvation of the Lord. We shall see breakthrough. We shall see the strength of the Lord in our lives. And we will understand that we are the beloved of God, called and set apart for such a time as this. Holy Spirit, enter, teach, rule, reign. Provide us with knowledge and breakthrough in our understanding, that we become the men and women you called us to be before the foundation of the world, holy God. In Christ's name, we call these things done, so, and sealed. You believe that? Amen. One statement that I made in our last time together is that we have a responsibility to rule well. The Lord has put us in the earth to be rulers. He hasn't just put us here to be churchgoers. He didn't just put us here to get saved. And many people stop at salvation and never step into the greater levels of development, into the greater levels of leadership, into the greater levels of understanding that God has a kingdom that the Lord wants to be advanced. It's always been his agenda. It's always been his desires. And the eyes of the Lord go to and fro in the earth looking for people that he can advance the kingdom through. And so I am excited about you. I'm excited about your life. And I'm wanting you to be able to move into the glory and the power and the greatness and the bigness of God. But remember, we're to rule well. I really believe this. I believe the greater the intimacy we have with God, the greater the power of God that flows through our lives. And you need to have the power of God to flow through your life as a mother, as a son, as an entrepreneur, as an employee, as an employer. Wherever you go, wherever you live and work and play, you haven't just been called to be there. You've been called to be there to be a demonstration of the power of God and the glory of God that can flow through any of us when we get activated by him and realize, I am a power agent of the kingdom of God. Now, I do want you to understand this. It's not the way of God to release authority to us and to have us exert it and we not even have a real relationship with Christ. God doesn't want people who don't know him and who aren't striving to know him to move in power and authority. But he doesn't, on the other end, want people who know him to be devoid of power. So we've got it working two ways. There are people that want authority without intimacy, and there are people who want intimacy, but they don't want authority and power. Many people live like that because many people haven't been told that the Lord wants you to be a power demonstrative agent in the earth. But the kingdom of God is different. When we look at the life of Christ, we see that not only was he full of love, not only was he full of compassion and connection with the Father, he was also full of power that he has passed to us, that we would be able to rule and reign in the earth and rule it well. We have a responsibility to rule well. And yes, we're to love and we're to do kind deeds and we're to feed the hungry and we're to clothe the naked. All of those things are good. But I want you to understand this, man and woman of God. You also have a mandate to be an instrument in God that routs every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. See, there is an inherent accountability in the command that we have to subdue the earth. I know that in Genesis 1, it said that let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. Now, the authority that God has given us, the power he's given us, it's not just for animals. That's not all that's about. It's to walk over and through everything that would stand against the power of God trying to move in our life. And what God wants from us is to know that you're not an animal trainer. And that scripture is not referencing being an animal trainer. That scripture is talking about you've got a command to be able to rule and subdue in the earth, to cause the earth to be cultivated by the glory of God, the supernatural gifts of God, and all the things that you carry, the endowments that you have, the graces that are upon your life. All of those things are to be used to cultivate the earth. So you're not an animal trainer. You're a kingdom ambassador. That's the real deal. And again, we've been called to bring the earth into alignment with God's kingdom. I want you to do something. I want you to turn to the book of Matthew, the 6th chapter. Matthew, the 6th chapter, very familiar scripture and one that is often quoted. But how many of you know that it's time to quit quoting and start being? It's time to quit quoting and start doing. So Matthew 6 and verse 10 says this, very familiar to all of us. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's all the 10th verse says as a part of the prayer that the disciples prayed. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth. Now, here's what I want us to understand, because I think the body of Christ has gotten this twisted. This statement is not an automatic release. It is not something that just is. It is something that has to be spoken and therefore then being released, caught, and activated through those, meaning you and I, that God has put into the earth to manifest the kingdom coming and to be able to steward the kingdom in the earth and the will of God being carried out in the earth. We are God's primary points for that. So this statement of supplication to God, we're to lift this up and be ready to demonstrate it. We're to lift up, Father, let your kingdom come. And as that kingdom enters into our lives, as it enters into the places where we often say live and work and play, we're to demonstrate the workings of that kingdom. This is the way it was for the disciples, and it's the way it was for us. God wanted them praying that prayer so that every day, every week, every moment, they could call in at any time the kingdom of God to come into whatever situation, whatever matter was going on. Brothers and sisters, that's the authority that we have. And it's to be instruments in the hand of God, hear this, to broaden and increase God's kingdom. Not your kingdom, not my kingdom, not a denomination's kingdom, not a particular stream's kingdom, whether it's mega, whether it's seeker-friendly, whether it's church growth, or whatever some of these models are. Our responsibility is not to enlarge those more so than we enlarge the kingdom of God. We've been called to be instruments in the hand of God to broaden and increase his kingdom in the world right now. Not when a new heaven and earth are set up, but we're to do this right now. That's our assignment. That's the authority that has been transferred to us by our Lord. Turn with me into the Old Testament to the book of Daniel. I want to look at the fourth chapter in the book of Daniel, and I believe it's going to bless you in a tremendous way as we're understanding the importance of intimacy through all these times of teaching. But now we're getting a greater understanding that power is supposed to come out of that intimacy. So look at Daniel, the fourth chapter and the 17th verse. Daniel 4:17. Daniel writes this. This sentence is by the decree of the heavenly watchers, and the decision is by the word of the holy ones to the intent. Hear this. That the living may know, the living may know, you're the living, I'm the living, that we may know that the Most High God rules the kingdom of mankind. And look at this. And it says, he gives it to whomever he will and sets it over the humblest and lowliest of men. Follow me here. You and I are the whomever and who will. God gives the kingdom to whomever he wills to give it to. When I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, when I repent and turn from my sins and I denounce all of those things and I come into this greater knowledge of who God is, I must understand that I'm stepping into his kingdom. And when I open myself up to him, the more that I allow the kingdoms that have been built in me by my soul for all the years that I lived until I got saved, he wants those kingdoms destroyed so that the kingdom of God begins to live inside of us. And he gives the kingdom to whosoever that he wills to give the kingdom to. And he sets it over even the most humble. And he sets it over the lowliest. Because every one of us are to live subjected to the kingdom of God. Here's what I want us to understand. This doesn't mean that we're to be earthly terrorists. And many believers are living as earthly terrorists. We're not cultivating the earth. We're trying to move in things that God would never call us to touch or to be a part of, believing that we are pulling down, rooting out, destroying, and throwing down. And that is good to do, but it must be the things that God has called us to do, because we can't live trying to pull down every evil, because even scripture says the wheat and the tare will grow up together and God will relinquish the ultimate judgment. But we're to be earthly cultivators. When I say earthly cultivators, we've got to cultivate the earth by the principles of the kingdom, moving in the power and the authority that God has given us so that the beauty of Jesus can be seen. You and I are causing Jesus to look good or causing Jesus to look bad. But when we move in the authority of God and the ways of his kingdom, and when we're coming out of a life lived in great connectedness to Jesus, we become earthly cultivators so that the beauty of Christ is then seen. Turn with me to the book of Psalms, the 8th chapter and the 6th verse. And we're going to wrap up in there this morning. But I want to read this to you because I believe that it is a beautiful text written and given to us so that we can again perfect our position even more in Christ Jesus. I mean, God has done something unique in you. God has done something special in you that I don't want you to miss. And you can sit in churches and miss what God has for you. You can be in religious settings around religious people. You can even be around saved people. And if you're not careful, you will miss the assignment that God's got for you. He didn't just give you power and then just give you authority so that you can practice on one another, but he's given it to us so that we can bring change in the earth by the wisdom, the revelation, the insight of God, all these things that come from his spirit that give us advantages so that we can be able to advance what he stands for. Look at Psalm 8:6. The writer says, you made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. God has made man to have dominion over the works of his hands. Everything in the earth was made by God. He's given us power and dominion to have authority over the works of his hand, because we're his agents in the earth. Scripture goes on to say, you have put all things under his feet.
All things are under your feet. Sickness is under your feet. Disease is under your feet. Fear is under your feet. Anxiety is under your feet. Addiction is under your feet. Why? Because you have dominion over everything that exists, and we have to begin to take dominion in our own lives as a governing agent and put those things that are under our feet, cause them to stay under our feet. He says, you have put all things under his feet. I love the church, but the church has failed miserably at this. But I'm telling you what I see. I see the Lord beginning to raise up an army of people just like you and I who are seeing things differently. And as we're being raised up in God, we're beginning through teachings like this and what others are doing, we're beginning to understand the directives that we have. We're beginning to understand the commands that we have. We're beginning to understand the instructions that we have. And worshiping and basking in God is great. And reading the word is great. And going to church is great. But I'm telling you, there's a call to action that God is moving his body of believers into. And there's an army that, again, is responding to his directives, his commands, and his instructions. And I rejoice over the fact that you're a part of that army being built up through this and through other teachings into the authority that you've got so that you rule well in everything God's called you to put your hands to. I'm excited about you and can't wait to see who you become, not in the future, but in the immediate future, not by power nor might, but by his spirit, our God, our King, our Lord. So thank you, Father God, for your presence. Thank you for grace to rule well. Thank you for the authority that you have given us. Thank you that you have given us your kingdom, that you've placed it over us. We thank you so much that as it's placed over us and as you've transferred authority to us, we will demonstrate that and live that out. If we are the humblest or if we are the lowliest, you have given us dominion and placed things over under our feet, and we will carry that out. God, give us new revelation and insight for what we have gained that we may walk it out. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. See you next time. Bring somebody with you, okay? Take care. I'm out. Peace.